Today's video is a follow-up and more of a confirmation of an old theory that I had where Sato trained Kreese and Terry Silver. And after working on a video, I noticed something I never paid attention to before. Now I'll post the video below, as well as put it at the end of my theory in this video. So right here, Johnny's pants of his gi has this symbol on it. This is Sato's dojo's symbol. Miyagi's father taught Sato and Miyagi. So what's interesting to me is that Cobra Kai has some Miyagi-Do in it, or rather, Sato's variation of Miyagi-Do, the same one that Chozen was teaching to students in Okinawa. Kreese's photo that hangs on his wall in his dojo back in 1984, the one that Daniel stops to look over when he goes to check out the dojo, was dated 1970 to 1972 Karate Champion. When we saw him in Cobra Kai, those flashbacks of him in the war, that was 1968, and that was only the beginning for Kreese. So after this, for the next 2 to 4 years in that flashback time, he's been continuing his karate training and journey that he started off with his captain in Vietnam. You know, the same one that he killed. As the war continues, my theory is that I mentioned how Kreese and Silver stopped in Okinawa at some point, and there's factual evidence that I include in that video that really explains how this is plausible. Kreese and Silver stop at Kadina Air Base at some point, in my theory, where they were trained by Sato, who taught the American military men the ways of Miyagi-Do, or Sato-Do. I think then we could get Kreese and Silver going off to Korea and actually learning more Tang Soo Do Karate. We've merely seen the introduction to Kreese in the war and his first step into karate from his captain. I could see us getting more flashbacks of Kreese and Silver really helming an A-team of their own, or should I say, a Cobra team, as they progress into the years. I think Kreese will hold a karate tournament within the war for the American troops, training them the way of the fist and to never show mercy. For here and on the streets, a man confronts you. He is the enemy. Now I'm going to link the video down below if you just want to watch that, and I'll also put it at the end of this one just for your ease of viewing. Hope you enjoy it. Let me know what you think of this theory. Let me know if you saw this symbol on Johnny's gi ever before. Let me know if you think it's actually Miyagi-Do or they just threw it in there. I think this is definitely part of the storyline of Karate Kid 1 and 2. The fact that they made Sato to be the trainer for American military men that were stopping in Okinawa, really, to me, makes sense that all of this would have happened with Kreese and Silver and so on. And from a writing perspective, it all just adds up to further the story. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Until then, remember, pain does not exist in this dojo, does it? Hey guys, now here's a theory that has some real concrete evidence to it. And if true, this could be the biggest thing that could happen in season 3, and possibly the secret that Miyagi was keeping. So here we go. In Karate Kid 2, when Daniel and Mr. Miyagi arrive in Okinawa Airport, Daniel stops to admire Sato's advertisement on the wall, where we see Sato breaking a large log, where Daniel asks Mr. Miyagi if he can do that, and Mr. Miyagi jokingly says, "Don't know, never been attacked by tree." Now, the advertisement boasted that Sato is the martial arts trainer for American soldiers over the last 40 years. Now, considering the timeline was 1986, Sato would be around 60 years old, or close to, because him being anything younger than the age of 20 and training American soldiers would be a bit unrealistic. His training was for the American military and American military police stationed in Okinawa. He was commissioned by the American government and military to teach karate and lethal tactics for self-defense and attack, proven in combat, which he used during the war. This is why Kadina Air Base was so close to the village that Sato owned, or vice versa. Now, a bit of a history lesson is in order for us to really understand how this might actually be a possibility, and how the brilliant writers of Cobra Kai, Josh, John, and Hayden, could make this a possibility. Okinawa, which was under American governance between 1945 and 1972, was the Pentagon's main area of launch for the war in Southeast Asia, which made massive changes of almost 1 million residents in Okinawa. It was during the Vietnam War that the American military, which had already been stationed in Okinawa during the 1950 to 1953 Korean War, really came to be used. Following the 1965 dispatch of initial troops, over the following years, hundreds of thousands more Americans transited through Okinawa. Now, Kadina Air Base literally served as the Pentagon's hub for transport. There were over 1 million flights during the war, and that made it for an extremely busy airport, the most busy airport in the world at the time. Now, in this mass amount of flights, I find it hard to believe that some of the American military's best men, Kreese and Terry Silver, weren't stationed there or at least transitioned through there at some point during their fight. Now, this photo of Kreese in his dojo back in 1984 shows that he was Captain John Kreese of the US Army 1970 to 1972 karate champion. This falls perfectly in the timeline of Kadina Air Base being the hub for the American soldiers during the Vietnam War. Him being a karate champion and having that written in his framed picture from the military, also noting him as a captain, tells me that he was involved in karate during the war in some way, shape, or form. And if he was, then Sato was the one training him. This timeline falls directly within Sato's 40 years. In fact, it's only 14 years prior to Daniel and Mr. Miyagi coming to Okinawa, which they did in 1986. This would leave me to strongly theorize that Sato did indeed train both Kreese and Terry Silver firsthand at some point in time during the war. At the very least, they would have met. Now, there's also the other possibility, which is a bit more far-fetched. However, it's Sato being flown out by the American government and paid to train American soldiers on American soil. And maybe Uncle Sam would do this because of how well he trained his men at Kadina Air Base during Vietnam. Now, here's where things get even deeper. In Karate Kid 3, Terry Silver is the owner of Dynatox Industries. He's a wealthy billionaire. Now, this company of his dumped nuclear sludge anywhere in the world, and Kadina Air Base was one place that had tons of chemical weapons and atomic warheads placed there in the 50s and 60s. This led to the world realizing that there wasn't just a base on the island of Okinawa, but rather, the island itself was the base. With so many chemical weapons, it makes me wonder if Dynatox ever had a hand in taking those weapons and possibly being responsible for dumping them somewhere in the world. Next, now that whole spiel with Silver telling Mr. Miyagi and Daniel in regards to him and Kreese being trained by South Korean Kim Soon-young of Cobra Kai could have been a total lie. It could be, in fact, that once they were enlisted in the army, that they began their karate training. Imagine if Sato's karate was what inspired Cobra Kai. Now, let's play devil's advocate and say what Silver said was completely true, that Kim Soon-young was honestly their teacher and master. This would mean they had prior karate knowledge and training, and once they got to the army, they joined Sato as his team of elite trainers, perhaps, to help recruit more Cobra Kais into the army, creating a badass team in the jungle. There are definitely some stories here that would be worthy of a spin-off series, 100%. Now, if Sato did train Kreese and Silver, then Cobra Kai is merely the dark side of Miyagi-Do with Sato's twist. Since we know that Miyagi's father taught both Miyagi and Sato, it would be Miyagi-Do that went on to indirectly create Cobra Kai. Imagine how Daniel would feel if Chozen tells him that Sato trained these two psychotic rebels in the army who went on to survive the war with this variation of Miyagi-Do, responsible for his very torment today and in the 80s. Once Daniel realizes this and tells Johnny, maybe Johnny would then understand that Cobra Kai and Miyagi-Do aren't really all that different after all. Maybe they're more similar than they thought. It's just what they're used for that defines them, good or bad. Now, Sato might have just taught Silver and Kreese his form of karate, Toguchi-Do, if you can call it that. So if that's the case, then Kreese and Terry might have just called it Cobra Kai themselves, which is also a possibility, branding it and then teaching it back in America in the Valley. Now, Chozen might not even know of Terry Silver or Kreese, but I feel like once Daniel and him reconcile their problems and become friends, pals maybe, then Daniel will possibly show a picture of Kreese and Silver and tell him about all of his troubles and the people behind it. And maybe those pictures will bring something to Chozen's attention. Maybe they went rogue during the army and Sato had a real problem with them and keeping them under control. Maybe they took everything that he taught and just completely changed it into their variation of karate or continued to use what they knew as Cobra Kai from Kim Soon-young, if that's a true story. Now, this is all a pretty crazy theory, but one that actually would make tons of sense and it's got historical facts to prove its legitimacy, along with Karate Kid 2 building the narrative for this theory. Now again, it's just a theory that I have, but I want to know what you all think. There are just tons of things here that add up, and if the writers ever used some information like this, then I think that'll be pretty neat. Having Daniel realize that Miyagi-Do, or Sato-Do, or Toguchi-Do, is really the reason behind Silver and Kreese being so successful and being so good at karate, then I think he's gonna have a real problem with it, and it might just change his perspective about Miyagi in general. Have an awesome rest of your day. Thank you for listening to this theory. Let me know what you think below, and I'll catch you in the next one. Until then, remember, pain does not exist in this dojo. Does it?
No, Sensei!
Last time on Cobra Kai Theory, I covered an interesting video regarding the analysis between Miguel Diaz fighting Johnny Lawrence, but from 1984. This is going to be a new series on the channel, and it's a lot of fun to make these kind of videos and to speculate with you all. Here's a snippet, and you can check out the rest, which I'll link below. So today's video, to start it all off, we'll start with Johnny Lawrence 1984 at the start of Karate Kid fighting Miguel Diaz, somewhere in the middle of Season 2. Now we can't say at the end of Season 2 because, well, yeah. So, Johnny fighting Miguel would be really interesting. Here we have Johnny, who was at the top of his dojo, the captain of Cobra Kai, if you will, John Kreese's best student against his own trained best student, 37 years later. Now I'm gonna get into the nitty-gritties of it, but I gotta say, I think both fighters equally have their talents and their faults. The thing that would make me choose Miguel is that he's trained by a more experienced Johnny, in basically a young Johnny's body. He's essentially Johnny in Karate Kid if current Johnny hopped in a DeLorean and traveled back in time to perfect his skill. Johnny taught Miguel the techniques that he used to be the best at his age, jump-starting him on his karate journey, and of course, perfected over 30 years. Now, of course, he probably wasn't training over those 30 years, as we saw in the beginning few episodes of Season 1, but the memory and the experience is still there. If we take note, Miguel's first fight in the tournament used the crane kick. This shows the evolution of Johnny's understanding of karate and how he implemented the old ways of 1984's John Kreese Cobra Kai.